Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. Republicans are continuing to refuse to do their job with regards to holding a hearing on Obama's Supreme Court pick. And from a purely political standpoint, this might actually be the best thing for progressives. And Paul Ryan appears to be abandoning his Ayn Rand political philosophy. We'll bring you the details in tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
With all of the disarray happening within the Republican Party, last week, a person stood up and actually tried to take leadership of the party. That person, surprisingly, was House Speaker Paul Ryan. As everyone knows, it was only recently that Paul Ryan became the Speaker of the House, and it appears that his new role has made him mature a little bit. Sure, he's still fighting with, you know, government shutdown possibilities and budget battles, but he gave a speech last Wednesday where he apologized, kind of, for his statements that in America you have some people that are makers and some that are takers. He said he regrets saying that and that it's not true. What we're seeing right now is somebody like Paul Ryan, who used to be considered a hardcore Tea Party extremist, he is trying to actually move to the center to try to unite his party and bring back a little sanity. While I am by no means a fan of Paul Ryan at all, this is admirable of him to do. He understands that as a country, we need two functioning political parties, at least. It would be great if we had more than two. But the Republican Party has to be able to function properly in order for government to run properly. And he understands that. Because he looks over at the Senate and he sees that these people won't even give Obama's court nominee a hearing. So maybe we're seeing a new Paul Ryan. Maybe he understands that the government has to work. And in order to do that, the Republican Party has to work. So kudos to Paul Ryan. President Obama has nominated Merrick Garland to fill the vacancy left on the Supreme Court following Antonin Scalia's death. While Democrats are divided on the issue, most had actually hoped that Obama would have nominated a more progressive judge, Republicans are united in their opposition to anyone nominated by a Democratic president. Joining me now to discuss this issue is attorney David Haynes. David, I have some personal feelings about Merrick Garland. Some progressives share them, some do not, and that's fine. But that's not even really the biggest issue about what has happened since President Obama nominated Merrick Garland. Regardless of the man's merits or, you know, shortcomings, the Republicans have decided no matter what, no matter who, no matter what President Obama does, they're absolutely not going to do their jobs. And that's not okay, really. I mean, in America today, you cannot have a Senate that says, we're not going to do what the Constitution says we have to do. What's your take on this whole situation unfolding out there?
It really is a low point for the Congress and really does symbolize just a complete congressional dysfunction and placing absolute pure politics over the constitutional duties and the needs of our republic. It really is a sad day. As you say, you know, Judge Garland is clearly a very centrist pick, someone who should be approved. He was approved overwhelmingly over about 20 years ago when he was elevated to the D.C. Court of Appeals. The Constitution is very clear. The president nominates and the Senate confirms, and they need to have a fair hearing. And it's juvenile, frankly, of the Republicans to be dealing this way. Oh, no one's going to meet with him. No one's going to receive him up on the Hill. You know, now, you know, one senator is going to, or two senators are going to. I mean, it's a joke, you know, that they were sent there, and this is going to be hurting Republicans politically. This is the American people are not in support this type of just pure political maneuvering at any cost.
But the Republicans themselves had actually suggested years ago that, hey, if you want a good person for the Supreme Court, why don't you pick this Merrick Garland character from the D.C. circuit? He is a great guy. We'd approve him. I mean, they said that. We have those quotes. We can see it. They suggested this man, and now they can't even, you know, muster the courage to stand up and say, okay, look, we're going to give you this one. We're at least going to give you a hearing. You know, maybe not a confirmation, but at least a hearing. They can't even do that.
Yeah, there's no question. I mean, if it was the roles were reversed and we had a Republican president in the White House and a Democratic Congress, I think it would not be unforeseen at all that Judge Garland would be the nominee in that sort of a situation, you know, because he really is a centrist pick. And so you have a number of people coming out, Republicans, everyone from Ken Starr to, you know, blast from the past, Alberto Gonzalez. And I mean, a lot of people from the George W. Bush administration all saying, you know, both sides saying that this is a man of integrity, of honor. He's someone who has respect for precedent, values the Constitution. And so, you know, no one has a bad thing to say about this guy. What it comes down to is that the Republicans believe this is their seat. This is Justice Scalia's seat. So this is the far right wing seat, and they're not going to give it up. The president has 11 months left in office. For them to say that it should be the will of the American people, of course, it is the will of the people. They elected President Obama. It just happened that Justice Scalia, you know, passed away with 11 months left in office. So, you know, if Garland is not given a hearing, and which appears they're saying he's not going to be. Pressure is mounting. But if he's not given a hearing, then I believe the court is going to go two terms with this vacancy. And that's unacceptable and is frankly pretty unprecedented in U.S. Supreme Court history.
Well, and it's interesting, too, because I think the number is about 75 court vacancies throughout the United States that are waiting for President Obama to nominate and the Senate to confirm across this country. So, you know, we're not just talking about the Supreme Court either here. You know, for the last 8 years, Republicans, their job has been to prevent any court appointments, you know, lower courts to the highest court. And so it's really just this overall attack on the judiciary. They want to make sure that they keep corporate friendly judges, conservative judges. Those seats are, as you said with Scalia, those are their seats. And they don't want to give them up because they know it's going to be bad for corporations if we get a justice out there that says, look, I care about consumers' rights. I care about companies lying to you to save a few dollars. And that's what I base my rulings off of. So, you know, this is a huge attack by Republicans. And I hope every viewer watching this understands that this does stretch far beyond the Supreme Court. Now, that is probably the most important one. But we have 75 other seats out there that Republicans have been blocking for years at this point.
Yeah, there's no question. We have a tremendous backlog in the federal judiciary. And we see this in the courts. Those of us that are practicing and litigating in the courts regularly see the effect of this is that the judges on our federal bench are overworked. They're overwhelmed. They don't have the staff and the resources to be able to hear all the cases. It's very difficult on the sitting judges. And it's a disservice, of course, to the community and those litigants who have matters that needed to be decided, whether you're an individual, you're a corporation, or whatever side you're on, we need the appropriate resources on the federal bench. And so you have Republicans who are refusing to do that and fill these vacancies because of pure politics. And so the Republicans are, I think, really getting in a situation. And you know, in the last 20 years, there's just been really a sea change that, of course, any bipartisan compromise and effort is gone by the wayside. When you look at a candidate like John Kasich, who prides himself on being able to get things done and reach deals and compromise in Washington during his time here in the Congress, he now is, of course, being rejected as the centrist candidate or the anti-Trump candidate by the other establishment folks like Jeb Bush and Lindsey Graham and so forth, that they are all, you know, swinging to endorse Cruz. So this is where we are, is that the Republicans, you know, they're not going to give a hearing to a centrist justice. They're endorsing Ted Cruz. I mean, this is the current state of the Republican Party, and it's not pretty.
Well, I feel like with the Republicans in general, common sense left the party a long time ago. And those who still exhibit, you know, some form of centrality, some form of neutrality on some issues, saying, look, maybe it's this, maybe it's this, I don't know. Those people are swept aside. They're seen as being out of touch, and they get replaced by people like Ted Cruz. And now even Ted Cruz isn't extreme enough, so they go to Donald Trump. And what they don't see is that this obstruction from these extremists in the Senate, as you pointed out earlier, it's already hurting them in the polls in most areas. Now, there are a few polls that show the Republican base actually does like this. And if they block a nominee, it makes them more likely to support the Republican senator. But in most areas, in most areas of this country where Republicans are up for re-election in the Senate, this is going to absolutely destroy them in November, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very important. The balance of the Senate is going to be very important. And of course, the DSCC and other groups will be targeting, you know, specific Republican senators who are in, swing states, who have, not on this particular issue with Judge Garland, that they're not going to vote to give him a hearing, not meeting with him and so forth. That's going to be a particular focus in this election and the cycle, and it's going to make them more vulnerable, and it should. And the American people, you have a fringe part, the hardcore right wing, and we've seen the surge of the Tea Party here in the last 10 years, and that's all affecting it. But a lot of the mainstream Republican voters believe, yeah, sure, the Supreme Court is supposed to have 9 justices, so let's get on with it. And they seem intent to try to hold off till after the election and, maybe not look at this in a lame duck session. But, if we have a Democratic president being elected, they may wish that they had confirmed Judge Garland.
Right. Yeah. If we end up with Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders as a Democratic president, I can promise you the nominee is probably going to be a lot more liberal than Merrick Garland. And they're absolutely going to regret this. The bottom line is the American public elected these people to do a job, whether they like the nominee or not. It's their job to give a hearing, whether we like the nominee or not. They still have to give the man a hearing. That's their job. Obama did his. It's time for the Senate to step up. Unfortunately, we're out of time. David Haynes, thank you very much for talking with us today. We'll see where they go with this.
That's right. Yep. Hopefully they'll give him a hearing. They should.
Thank you.
Thank you, Farron.
Last week's primaries were unique, to say the least, both in terms of the results and the voting irregularities that occurred in Arizona. I was able to speak with Ring of Fire Radio Sam Cedar about this, so let's take a look.
The reality is that Donald Trump is actually closer to getting 1237 in many respects than Hillary Clinton is in getting the magic number for the Democrats, which is 2,383. Now, I want to put a caveat there. The Democrats don't run their primaries like the Republicans. Republicans don't run them like the Democrats. The Democrats also have approximately 700 superdelegates. Now, I, for one, do not believe that we will ever see a situation where the superdelegates cast their votes with the person who does not achieve the most pledged delegates. Now, you'll recall Barack Obama needed the superdelegates to cross over the threshold of 2,383 in 2008. And Hillary Clinton was only about 130 delegates behind him in terms of the pledged delegates,
right,
if I remember correctly.
And she actually had gotten more popular vote than Obama, but was behind in the delegate count just due to states. So they could have technically justified, switching to Hillary.
But I think, look, this is a suicide mission, right? I mean, the Democratic Party knows they've got to give the superdelegates got to pledge themselves to the winner of the pledged delegates. Now, they may declare earlier for somebody else because that's their way of influencing the press and the narrative that somebody's inevitable or not. But I think that only goes so far. I definitely think that people sort of overestimate the relevance of this. I get very pissed off when I see mainstream media including the superdelegates in with the pledged delegates account, amounts. And we're starting to see a little bit less of that because it's a joke. Everybody knows the superdelegates are going to go by way of the pledged delegates. So without that, with that said, We have Alaska, Washington, and Hawaii. Washington State, of course, having the big prize, 101 delegates. This race is still mathematically possible for Bernie Sanders, and there's no reason for him to drop out until it isn't, as far as I'm concerned.
Oh, I agree 100%. I mean, regardless of what happens from this point, Bernie Sanders needs to stay in this race because he's helping to dictate, the conversations that are being had, and they're conversations that have to be had. I mean, he has injected a level of populism and honest progressivism into this campaign that we would not have seen had he not entered. So his presence is so vital for this conversation, and he absolutely has a path to victory, and I know the campaign has a plan and they're trying to make it happen. But to me, something I feel is getting grossly overlooked is the fact that if you look at Hillary Clinton's victories, the states that she has won, all but three of them have been states that are historically red in presidential elections. Now, that is not at all meant to undermine the voters in those states who picked Hillary Clinton, but because of the Electoral College, if those states stay red in 2016, those votes, they almost don't count. And that is a problem with the Electoral College. And so it's very dangerous for, Hillary Clinton's supporters to look at this and say that they have this huge momentum in these states. Super Tuesday, after Hillary Clinton won, she got up and she gave a speech where she said she has received more votes in every single state than any other candidate running in these primaries. And that is simply not true. That is absolutely a fallacy. Donald Trump received more votes in the state of Ohio than Hillary Clinton. And that is a swing state, and that is important. They were virtually tied in the state of Florida, another huge swing state. Those are important things that people have to start looking at. You know, winning red states in a primary can get you to the nomination, but it's not necessarily going to help you in the general election unless you can flip the state. And that is something we do not see very often in elections.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's some truth to that. But I mean, look, the reality is this is the way that Democrats have run their primaries. It's impossible to imagine that at the beginning of the year, if everybody had said, like, look, we're just not going to go to states that are traditionally red in general elections. We're just not going to count those. I mean, that would be silly, right? But on top of that, from a sort of a practical standpoint, and look, I prefer Bernie Sanders. Policies are more akin to mine. But let's just sort of analyze this rationally speaking. It's quite possible if Donald Trump is the nominee, there are going to be states that are going to be a lot more available to be flipped. States like Arizona could very well be. Could end up being a Democratic state. There are other states, it seems to me, the Indiana, maybe, I don't know, Utah, for that matter. It is hard to know exactly what's going to happen. So I think to a certain extent, this is the bottom line is there is no data that really anybody can make a solid case on that Hillary Clinton is more electable in a general election than Bernie Sanders is. I mean, to the extent that there's any data, it shows more or less parity, maybe even that Bernie Sanders polls a little bit better. But I wouldn't invest much in those polls one way or another. I mean, people say, well, Bernie Sanders has not been, been under the Klieg lights in a national general election. But, Hillary Clinton hasn't either. And we just don't know. We just don't know. We haven't seen full-on attacks against Bernie Sanders. Well, that's true. But we also haven't seen Donald Trump full-on attack Hillary Clinton. There's simply no data. We can come up with theories, and I certainly could come up with theories where I would think that Bernie Sanders might be more electable because he undercuts someone like Donald Trump's appeal. But we don't know that it's going to be Donald Trump. For all we know, it could be Paul Ryan. So these electability arguments, I think, are red herrings. I think people should go out there, vote for the person that they think is best equipped to represent their views and to execute them. I mean, that's what a primary is about. And then, frankly, in the general election, in my opinion, you go out there to vote to keep someone like Donald Trump or Ted Cruz, or frankly, Paul Ryan, right, who would, you know, he may be apologizing for every belief he's held that has been represented in every policy that he has promoted for years. But I don't buy it. And if you genuinely are concerned about the least fortunate amongst us, if you're genuinely concerned about social justice and economic justice, then frankly, you know, you should be prepared to vote for an inanimate object against one of these Republicans. I'd vote for a shoe before I would pull the lever for Paul Ryan or Donald Trump or Ted Cruz. But that's just me. Of course, we had the Democratic and the Republican primaries. We had a lot of turnout. I know you got some of those turnout numbers, but there was also major problems. And I fear that this could be a harbinger for things to come. But major, major problems with the voting in Arizona.
People having to wait 5 to 6 hours just to cast a ballot in a primary. And this wasn't an accident. This wasn't because they predicted lower than average voter turnout. The state of Arizona had cut down the number of polling places by 70%, cut it down from over 200 down to 60. And, you know, with the new restrictive voter ID laws and everything else the state had put in place, which, again, is all their plan to disenfranchise, you know, Democratic voters, essentially. You know, this is what they were hoping for. This is what they wanted. And so we're going to see more of this, especially in the general election. But here is the silver lining with what happened in Arizona this week. We know about it now. If turnout had been low enough, we would not have seen these problems. We would not have recognized them. And that is one reason why it is so important for everyone. I don't care if you're a Bernie, you're a Hillary, you have to get out there, because we have to expose these problems before November. If we don't know about them, we cannot fix them. Because if this happens in November, this is going to kill the Democratic Party. Because when you look at the voting base of the Republicans, you know, they skew older, they're retired, they can wait. They can sit in a line for 5 hours. When you look at the Democratic voting base with these, you know, college students and the working class people, they don't have that kind of time. You know, a lot of people go vote before they head into work or on their lunch break. They can't sit in lines for hours and hours. So it's only going to benefit Republicans. And that is why for these remaining primaries and caucuses, we've really got to get every single able-bodied person out there to cast a vote, and let's shine a light on these voting problems before they kill us in November.
Yeah, and you know, I think the bottom line is, you know, we see this as voting apparatus is one of the first things that are always cut because there's a disregard, particularly, you know, amongst Republicans. I mean, this is I don't think it's controversial to say that Republicans have always seen voter suppression as a tactic that benefits them. And, of course, you know, it basically allows people to get government on the cheap, but they pay with their democracy. And it's, you know, that's not one of the things that you can pick up and put on your shelf. It's obviously a you know, a boiling frog scenario. So, yeah, it's very problematic. Let me touch on something else that happened this week. To a certain extent, part of the campaign as well, and that was the major candidates all addressed AIPAC, which, of course, is the pro-Likud right-wing, pro-Israel lobby, mainly Republican-supported AIPAC is. But they invite all the candidates. And if for Republicans, apparently, like Newt Gingrich and Mitt Romney, they will allow the candidates to deliver their address by video. But when it comes to Bernie Sanders, no, they wouldn't allow that. So Hillary Clinton spoke in front of AIPAC. She gave a speech, and, you know, a lot of people were anticipating, even Hillary supporters, that she would be more to the right than they had hoped, that she would might come across as a little bit neoconish. Well, I think even those people who had the worst expectations were even were disappointed by this. I mean, she came off, she was extremely strident. She was attacking President Obama over the successful Iran negotiations. She was attacking things like, protest movements against Israeli settlements. She barely mentioned the word settlements, maybe once in passing. She, I don't know if she said the word Palestinians, but when you contrast that with Bernie Sanders' speech, which frankly, I think was the most comprehensive statement he has made on foreign affairs since the beginning of his campaign. I think it was, frankly, it came too late. I would have liked to have seen that earlier in the campaign. Maybe he thought this was the one time where he could afford to do it, but he actually dared to say that the Palestinians are human beings and have some rights too. And so, of course, this was fairly controversial, but only in those very narrow AIPAC circles. Donald Trump went and spoke, and the head of AIPAC, in one of, you know, the most disingenuous apologies of the week, short of Paul Ryan's apology, said that he didn't realize how inappropriate Donald Trump would be to President Obama. This is laughable on its face. This is the chief truther, you know, birther of the country. I mean, if somebody didn't realize that Donald Trump was going to be disrespectful to the president before they got invited, they must have been living under a rock. So I don't put much stake in that. But it was fascinating to see Bernie Sanders actually make a very strong but also cohesive. I mean, this was not just simply he was taking a position, which he did, and a position which I happen to agree with on this Palestinian-Israeli conflict. But he gave out, put out a very thoughtful, comprehensive foreign policy statement, which is not been, we have not seen that much of, frankly, from Bernie Sanders. He's been, chose to focus more on a domestic agenda, of course, because that's, you know, that's what he's most interested in, and that's what his campaign has been built upon. But I found that pretty impressive. And then just, we just got 60 seconds here, Farron. Or actually, I guess 30, but I just want to get this out there. Fascinating story in Harper's Magazine, a report which said that writer Dan Baum spoke to John Ehrlichman, who was President Nixon's chief domestic policy advisor, and he asked him about the drug war. And Ehrlichman stopped him and said, "Don't even, it was all about black people and hippies." So there's just something, a little tiny fact. Or a report, I should say, for the week. Chew on that, folks, as we move forward. Farron, as always, a pleasure. Thanks so much for helping out this week.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. And you can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com. And you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.